Hi, I'm Jeff Pops, CEO of Hidden Path Entertainment, and I wanted to share our experience with you about what it was like to plan and then launch and live through the Defense Grid 2 Kickstarter that we did. Kickstarter is an amazing and very interesting opportunity for game developers, but it's also a really interesting challenge too, to try and pitch your game ideas to the general public and then get them to bid on a game product that you haven't made yet. And I'm going to talk a little bit about why we thought we might be able to do it, give you a little bit of background on Defense Grid, and then go into how the Kickstarter went for us and share a lot of data with you about what we found. So, to give you some background on Defense Grid launched in December of 2008 on the PC on Steam, and then all the way in September 2009 on the Xbox 360. We've sold over 750,000 units to date before we started the Kickstarter, and it's been really popular. On Xbox Live Arcade, it's the 20th highest rated game by players out of, at the time, 520 games on Xbox Live Arcade. And from Steam, we can see it's a really sticky game. The average time played is around 20 hours, and the median time played is around 5.5. Half of the people have played more than 5.5 hours, half have played less. And this is actually pretty high for a video game that's available on Steam. And your average play session, as you see there, is an hour. The Metacritic the game rankings are around 84%, user score 9.2 on Metacritic. We've had a lot of people really excited about the game. And so it all started in 2007. We went around pitching this game to publishers. And at the time, there were a lot of flash games of tower defense. And we thought, hey, we can bring something new to this. And we heard, no, tower defense games are free. No one's going to pay for it. We definitely don't want to invest in a game that no one wants to pay for. No, let's not get involved in that. And then we started thinking about, well, maybe we would self-publish it, and we approached Microsoft to see if we could get a slot for Xbox Live Arcade, which was fairly new at that time. And they said, yes, we'll grant you a slot for next summer. And we said, great. And then we went to try and, you know, get enough money so that we could make it ourselves and raise some money and take some money from some other projects we did. And in November, we actually started development with our own money and investment from others to get the game underway. By the time we got March 2008, the Microsoft folks we were talking with were really excited about, you know, what we our progress, how things have been going, and they said, hey, we actually want to announce this game at Game Developers Conference. And this was really new, because typically an Xbox Live Arcade game was only announced within a few weeks to a month before it released. And in fact, we had to rush to get the name for the game, because we hadn't locked down the name. At the time, we were calling it Last Stand, but Last Stand wasn't available. And so we you know, did a research, got the trademark for Defense Grid, and we went off and announced it with Microsoft at March. In May, we had a vertical slice that we showed to Microsoft, and at this time, they got some new management in for Xbox Live Arcade, and they had some new plans, and they saw our game, and they were kind of confused, because the new plans, I guess, didn't involve our game being out on Xbox Live Arcade in summer of 2008, but they liked what they saw, and so they weren't sure what to do. So what they actually told us is that they were going to delay our slot a year into 2009, and this was difficult for us because we had spent our money, we needed to see revenue, and so we decided we could add a PC version, we could spend more on the game, and release that still in 2008. And that pushed us back. It ended up being until December of 2008 until the PC version was able to release. But we were able to do that. And so in December, we launched on Steam at $20 with no marketing. The sales were okay, but really good reviews started coming in, and we were very excited. The next year, in 2009, we launch an Xbox Live Arcade as soon as our slot is available, and we were going to launch at around $15, but at the time, Microsoft had gotten hit by a lot of the Summer of Arcade games that came out just before us being at $15. And so they said, no, you know, we can set your price, and we're going to set it at $10. And we were a little frustrated by this, to be completely honest, and we decided, well, we probably should match that on Steam. So we ended up lowering our Steam price to $10 as well. looking back, we had $15 worth of content. We probably should have kept our Steam price at $15. But interestingly, the sales were still very good, and the reviews were as if the game had improved when it was really the exact same game that we had originally made for XBLA, released on PC, and then finally got to release on Xbox Live Arcade. December, the Steam holiday sale was a real big impact for us, and we saw PC revenues really climb. And in 2010, it's been out now on both Xbox and PC. We're seeing some decent revenues start to come in. And we started talking with publishers and investors about making a Defense Grid 2, and there were some really good talks there. We then decided in June to release our first paid downloadable content on both Xbox and PC, and that went really well and sold really well, and the game even sold better. And so we were really excited about how things were doing. And that December in 2010, we actually said, this Kickstarter thing's kind of interesting, and the publishers are taking a long time. Maybe we should look at this. And because we just didn't see any projects getting funded larger than $150,000, we decided that, maybe that wasn't yet the right venue for us, but of course later on we would take a shot. So in 2011, in February, we were still talking with publishers, and we had so many close calls where it's like, yeah, well, let's do this Defense Grid 2 deal. And then we start getting the details, and it's like, oh, maybe, maybe not. And around that time, the Valve folks had contacted us and asked if we wanted to be part of an alternate reality game for the launch of Portal 2. And in this, GLaDOS invites, 12 different indie games. And so, it was really exciting, and in fact, GLaDOS got involved in Defense Grid, and there was a couple of levels there where we did some stuff, and we said, this would be a really good expansion, we thought. And so we asked the Valve folks if we could do a full expansion featuring GLaDOS, and they gave us their permission. They said, go ahead. And then that July, the Steam Summer Sale is even one of the best performances we've ever had for Defense Grid, and so we start thinking about, wow, we really need to get this sequel going, and we start talking about Kickstarter again, but again, it doesn't seem like it's raising enough money, to make the kind of sequel that we want to do. That December, we released Defense Grid U Monster. The sales were really strong. On Steam, on Xbox 360, we came out the same day as the Dash redesign, and the sales on Xbox 360 just completely plummeted. We didn't see any sales whatsoever because it just became so hard to find games on the Dash. And that Dash update also started affecting some of the Defense Grid users, and we tried working with Microsoft to fix that, but that was not something that we were able to address, and we hadn't ever seen in any of the testing. As we come into 2012, we see in February Double Fine Adventure launch, and all of a sudden we really see some serious Kickstarter potential, and that's really exciting. And they have a lot of capability at Double Fine that we weren't sure if we had, and we'll get to that in a little bit in the presentation. But we were really excited with what that meant. And by the time we hit March, we actually broke even on Defense Grid. We had been selling well each of the years, but we had spent a lot on the game, and we continued to reinvest in the game. And finally, in March of 2012, we actually started making more money than we had spent on Defense Grid. Because we were trying to create a new franchise, because we were trying to create a new property for our game, was the reason we kind of allowed ourselves to spend more on the property. Typically, you don't want to keep investing in something that isn't just really bringing in return. But since this was an IP that us as a small developer owned, it was very important to us to try and kind of turn this into something that became really solid. We saw Wasteland 2 and Shadowrun in April also perform strongly on Kickstarter, and then in May, the last really close conversation about Defense Grid 2 completely fell through, and we said, okay, you know what, I think we're going to try and launch this Kickstarter and see what we can do. And one of the reasons we felt like Defense Grid was a large enough property to garner some interest on Kickstarter was that it had a really different sales curve. I'm going to show you a sales chart here that is really kind of unusual. Typically, a game will come out, it'll have sales for about 6 months to 9 months, and then really fall off. And as you look at the blue bars in this graph, you see that our initial 1 month of December had a little bit of revenue, $100,000. We started seeing about $425,000 of revenue come in 2009, about the same in 2010, which was really odd now. Now that should have fallen off dramatically. And in 2011, we're making even more money on Defense Grid than we had in previous years. And the yellow line shows the number of sold units of the main game, which kept increasing, and then the red is the number of expansion units that we kept adding to as Resurgence came out and then New Monster came out. And so we saw this really healthy trend of growth that we thought, okay, there's an audience out there that really wants more Defense Grid. Let's see if we can use Kickstarter to find a way to get that. So with that, we decided that having this large install base, perhaps we could turn to Kickstarter, help us make a sequel to the game. So our goal was to raise enough money so we could make Defense Grid 2, and in the process, build a tighter bond with our existing players. We had some relationship with our community, but not as much as a lot of indie developers, and we thought by getting involved in Kickstarter, that might help us. We could also grow our player community and also involve the community in our development. You know, involve people in beta testing, get more feedback from them, and really help us make a better product overall. Kickstarter doesn't have a great history of success overall. You know, as of August 25th, when I was preparing this presentation, over 68,000 Kickstarter projects had launched at this point, and almost 60% of them had failed, with about 40% making their funding. But a lot of those were trying to get very small dollar amounts funded. It costs a lot to make a video game. Defense Grid 2, for example, is a total budget of probably around $2 million, and we were trying to fund half of it from our own money and half of it from users' money. And so, you know, you're looking for a substantial amount of money. And in this case, if we just look at, you know, overall, any projects over $1 million, there had only ever been 8 in the history of Kickstarter out of almost 70,000. And on video games, there had only been 4. And if you even just wanted to be over $20,000 in video games, you're looking at less than 200 successful projects over about almost 3,000. So you could see, you know, on this graph, $20,000 to $100,000 on average on Kickstarter was about 2.82% of success, and it's about 5.75% of success if you're a video game. These are pretty tough odds that you're facing to try and have a successful Kickstarter. They're even more difficult odds than when you make a video game, where typically if you make a video game, you have somewhere between a 15% chance of having success with a video game for any particular one released. So knowing the odds were going to be against us and that we had to really work hard to try and be a successful group on Kickstarter, we said, okay, well, what can we do to be successful? And so we looked at what Double Fine, Wasteland, Shadowrun Returns had done, and we looked at also what had worked outside of the video games. The Order of the Stick was a great example of increasing what was going to get delivered as more money came in. And we saw limited discount tiers. It might have been done by others, but it was really popularized by the Pebble. And we followed all the Kickstarters very closely on a site called KickTrack, which had a lot of great data that we could look at. And then we went and talked with people who had done it. We talked with Greg Rice over at Double Fine. We talked with, Al Lowe at Leisure Suit Larry. We talked with Jordan Weissman from Shadowrun Returns. And we tried to learn, you know, how did people behave? What was unexpected? What were the operational challenges that we might face? What are things that aren't there right now in Kickstarter? One of the things we noticed is that it's kind of frustrating. You bid on something and then you have to wait. And is there a way we could give people instant gratification? And that, you know, Kickstarter was really for the small companies that don't have as much access to capital. And there are a lot of large companies who want, you know, the eyeballs from the people who are looking for cool new things. And we know that there's some really good people in some of these larger companies. So maybe if we partner with larger companies, maybe that would help us, you know, get them some access to audiences that they might not normally get. And maybe that would allow us to get some high value rewards for backers that we might not otherwise be able to provide. So that was some thinking that kind of led us to some of the things we did. And then we started showing our plan to others for feedback. We talked to people inside and outside of game development. We went and visited a lot of different people, and we put it in front of people, and we got lots of feedback and lots of, oh, I don't like that, I do like this. And we tried to really hone our pitch. We also looked, kind of compared our pitch with the other guys, and we noticed, you know, these were the categories we came up with, as, you know, the nostalgia factor seemed to have a really big impact on the other large video games that had happened, and Defense Grid isn't old enough for that. And they also had kind of a market absence for their product type. Double Fine, you know, you just aren't finding adventure games anymore, and Shadowrun, you aren't finding that kind of RPG as much anymore. Wasteland 2, you know, there's a Fallout is out there, and there's some other things that are kind of similar, but still pretty different. And of course, Tower Defense, we have something unique in Tower Defense, but there's a lot of Tower Defense games out there. You know, each of the others had really charismatic or recognized spokespeople, and we at Hidden Path, I think we're known, we have lots of friends and colleagues in the game industry, but we're not well known in, by public. And then, you know, do we have a large fan base? Well, that was actually an area where we competed well. We had over 750,000 people who had just purchased this game over the last couple of years, and while the other games, you know, other adventure games that Tim had made, or Wasteland, or Shadowrun had done well many years ago, you know, we were looking good there. And then we have a pretty good reputation for being able to deliver. And that's one of the things that, you know, a lot of people ask on Kickstarter, do I believe that I'm actually going to get something for when I give my money? And then a brand loyalty factor. And the, there are a few people who are really, really loyal to Defense Grid, but overall it doesn't have the same draw as a lot of these other IPs. So as we compared ourselves, we go, you know, we have some obstacles to overcome to try and get where we're going. So again, as I mentioned, we went and talked to people, and this was kind of the advice we got from several folks, from Greg at Double Fine. He said, really, you want to focus on the higher tiers. You got to get your average cost per pledge up, and really be careful of how much physical goods you ship. They not only do they cost a lot to make, but they cost far more than you would ever guess to ship, and they can really, really hit you. Jordan Weissman at Harebrained, you know, did Shadowrun Returns, and he said, look, everyone pays attention to anything we say in the video. We don't get very many questions from our infographic. We still get a lot of questions, even if it's written in our pledge tiers. When we write the text below, it's as if no one reads it, and absolutely no one reads the FAQ. If we put something in FAQ, we still get equal number of questions as if we never put it there. He says it's really important in his world to respond to every customer. To respond to every customer, and that even a simple thank you, you know, people would be so happy to actually hear from the developer that often they would say, well, I'm going to upgrade my pledge because you talked to me, and I appreciated that. And they had never expected that. They just said, well, we're going to say thank you to everybody. And he felt like adding tiers in the middle of the campaign made a huge difference and was something that you really had to focus on and plan to do. And so we took that advice into account. We talked with Al about Larry Returns. And he said, look, you know, keep the updates coming. The backers really want to hear from you. They want to know what's going on. They want to, you know, have their questions answered a lot. We talked with our friends over at Penny Arcade, Robert, Jerry, and Jeff, and Mike, of course, is over there. And you know, they said, look, expose the full game development approach. Show the steps behind the scenes that'll help make a game, and give backers a reason to not just pledge, but go tell their friends about it. That's going to be a really important thing. And then we talked to Jeff Keighley, you know, in Game Trailers TV, and said, you know, we're not as well known as some of these other people. What are we going to do? And we said, well, you know, one of the ideas we might have is asking other people in the game industry for help. And he said, oh, I think that's a real key. I think you really should do that. The more known people on the screen that others are going to see, that the increase in trust they're going to have. And so that was some of his advice. And then we looked at, okay, well, how much money can we raise and what can we build? And everyone would like, we would like, players would like games to cost less. But it turns out making video games just is pretty darn expensive if people get paid. And in our business, we have really high quality people here at Hidden Path. And so they of course take a salary, and that's not a bad thing. That's how they make their living. And so in the ideal, we could recognize if you could make a brand new game for $500,000, you could probably get it funded. But an expansion for our game costs somewhere between $200,000 and $250,000 to make. And in fact, now the expansion that we're working on right now looks like its budget's coming in right about $250,000. And we looked at Defense Grid 2, and we explored several different budgets, but the game that really delivers with, you know, supporting user content, really supporting multiplayer, getting the kinds of features the fans want in there, is probably a $2 million budget. And we just aren't, it was really unlikely we were going to raise $2 million. So we said, okay, let's put $1 million aside, the money that we have, that we've raised from Defense Grid and from other projects, and we're going to say, yes, we're going to commit that to Defense Grid 2, and let's see if we can raise the other $1 million to make that. And then now the question is, do we go out with $1 million as a minimum? And that seemed like a really bad idea, you know, because you could put a tremendous amount of work into this, and your reach, you know, depending upon how many people you could get in, could you get to a million or not? And we'll talk a lot about reach in a little bit. But we decided that if we could come up with something that, you know, in $250,000 increments, where if we raise $250,000, we could get some, you know, this for something, and then if we raise $500,000, we could deliver more, and if we could get all the way to a million, we could deliver everything. That seemed like the best way to have solid things we could do, where if enough people get involved, we're going to be able to deliver something for them. And that ended up being a little bit of a controversial approach, especially giving out the tiers kind of ahead of reaching the goals. But we felt like that was the right thing for us. We thought, well, we could just raise $250,000 only for an expansion, but we didn't seem like that was the most interesting offer. And our goal was to get to DG2, and you know, building this expansion is going to help us get us closer to DG2. So we felt like this is really about Defense Grid 2 and getting there, and we'll expose all the pieces of how we get there and how we work our way. So we came up with this infographic that kind of showed our different kind of steps in a kind of a puzzle piece format. And I think, you know, in retrospect, the $250,000 minimum level wasn't as interesting for people, wasn't as big a draw as we had hoped. But we definitely reached out to people who want more Defense Grid, and we're definitely going to deliver that for them. And so we started thinking about our pledge tier strategies, and we thought about discounted early bird tiers, adding new discounted tiers once others are full. We think that's really important. Limited tiers, where you keep them limited and you grow the limit as time goes on, that became something that you could do. And try not to have anything under $55 that had physical goods, because the physical goods just eat up so much. You know, 10% of what you're going to raise goes to the Kickstarter plus Amazon. And then the question is, you know, can you keep the part of physical goods that you're going to sell under, say, 20% of your tier, so that you can still raise money to make the game? It's not a great, if all I wanted to do was buy a t-shirt, it's really not the best way. But if my goal is to fund the game development and I can get a t-shirt as a reward, then keeping the t-shirt as 20% and the game development as 70%, you know, that was our objective here. And so even looking at, you know, how physical goods work, you know, you could maybe have a $2 poster up to a, you know, we're finding it's not just $7, $8, $9 shirts, depending upon how many colors and what all goes on it. And then shipping that to the United States from China, if it's made overseas, can cost $1 to $3 each. Then to put a thing in a box with a group that does this professionally, it's $3 to set the box and get the first thing in it, and another dollar per thing you put in the box. And then you gotta ship it, and it costs about $5 to $8 to send things to anywhere in the United States, and anywhere from five, sometimes six, seven, all the way up to $10 international more to send more stuff in a box, in that same box, and if the box gets bigger, the prices go up. So for a single item, you're running $10 to $21 dollars just to send it and get, you know, manufacture it, get it here, send it. And so then you're looking at pledge tiers of $50 to $100 if you want to keep that under 20%. So that was something we really focused on. So we thought, okay, is there a way we can help address some of the instant gratification? And we thought, well, we've got a game, and the game's kind of old, but a lot of people still don't know it. When they discover it, they go, wow, this is still a wonderful game. And doesn't feel old to them at all. It's kind of stuck around. And in many ways, it's stuck around because as other games come out, you know, we keep getting mentioned in reviews that, oh, well, it doesn't do this like Defense Grid, or, you know, Defense Grid's kind of the standard. And so that's really helped. And so we thought, well, why don't we give away the original Defense Grid as they pledge? And sure, they can always take their pledge away, and yes, we'll be out of code, but that's okay. We're going to try and get more people into the game, and maybe they'll play it, and maybe they'll like it, and maybe they'll come back. And then if everyone who's pledging can be part of the game, we can actually kind of have this be a party. We can't do contests or coupons on the Kickstarter site. That goes against the Kickstarter terms, but we can do that inside our own game. And so if we get everybody a copy of the game who's pledging and is a part of it, we can update the game every week, we can create new contests, we can put new content in there, and that's going to cost us money. And so this is where we thought, okay, we're trying for $1 million, so let's put some effort into this, and let's really, you know, keep the game exciting and add new content each week and do contests each week and see if that's, you know, that gets people more energized. And so that's what we decided to do. And we said, well, how are we going to do this? Because we don't get people's emails. from Kickstarter until the very end. And so we contacted Kickstarter and we said, well, hey, can you help us distribute these codes as people pledge? We're okay if they still get the code and they lose, you know, they drop out, but we want to deliver the codes to them. And they said, well, we have this way to do direct messaging and you can send codes if you want, but no, we're not going to help you with any kind of distribution system. And if you look there on the slide, that is the Kickstarter messaging system. You click on who it is and you type what you want and you hit send message. It's very manual. And so we said, well, what if we tried to do this on our own, but we maybe tried to automate it? And they said, well, you can do whatever you want, but you know, we're not going to help. And so, okay, so we figured out, we built some tools. And we actually invested in you know, C# is a great language for building tools, and we built a parser. It basically went through and it read every backer report and then copied all that data into our local database so we didn't have email information, but we got all the information of who was pledging and what they were pledging and if they changed their pledge. And then we did the same thing for all the message threads so that we could send emails to people from our database and then they would get inserted into the Kickstarter system, and that would be the third tool to actually send them. So the parser pulled in all the data and the sender would actually send messages. So that when we knew that someone pledged, all these processes run, they get added to our database, we could grab a code out of the database and it could automatically send them a message. And so we created, you know, this local SQL database that had a record for each person. It had a identification of whether or not they were getting, you know, what rewards they would get, and we had places to store their address once we'd get that, and what was their pledge amount and what reward level, and then, you know, we would add these messages, these templated messages that we started doing manually just to make sure it would work, and then we turned on the automation and they would send, you know, 800 messages to all these people as new backers came in, and they would receive messages in the Kickstarter messaging system because, again, we didn't have their email until the whole thing was over, and if it was successful, that sent them the code so that they could go to Steam and turn those in and get the game. And so then we'd update the game through it, and we made all these great, you know, mini games, and we added new content, and we added new challenge modes, and we reset the leaderboards and had contests, and because of some partners, we were able to give away really great prizes for the contests. And this probably took us about 3 people for 2.5 months who were totally focused on updating the game, making the game, and we had learned a lot from the alternate reality game around Portal 2, and we focused that learning right into this so that we could try and make this a really fun and exciting time. We also, of course, had to make a video. And so we felt like, okay, the video is going to tell people how much we really want to make Defense Grid, let people get to know who we are so that they can actually start to build a relationship with us. We can talk about our past so that new people can realize, hey, we're experienced, we can deliver this, we know what we're doing. We can let people see behind the scenes, see the guy who's the voice of Fletcher, our main character in the game. And we can talk about what the new game's going to be and what's going to have and what the money's going to go towards. And to do all this, we basically recorded all of this ourselves with Mark's, our design director's camera and his lights. It was a Canon 7D and some lighting. We bought a little audio recorder. I'm using it right now to record the audio for this video, and some lapel mics so we could mic ourselves. Turns out audio makes a really big difference in making a video seem more professional. You don't have the hissing sound. And then we use Premiere for making our videos, and basically every week I was editing new video that would go up so that we could tell our Kickstarter backers what's going on. And then we asked people to help us with our video because we're not as popular as a lot of other people, and we received a tremendous amount of help and outpouring. Randy Pitchford from Gearbox Software, Jordan, David Perry, Richard Garfield, Allo, Chris Taylor. I mean, what take from his wasn't funny. I'll never forget Ken Ralston singing on a ukulele that he wants more Defense Grid. Ken was so kind. Jason Vanderberg from Ubisoft, Dave Taylor, Sam Ernst, who's a producer and writer for Haven, who also writes for Defense Grid, actually took video footage on Haven's set, a sci-fi TV show, Vicky Tamaru, Alex News, and all these folks just jumped in to help, and we so appreciated their communal support to say, hey folks, you may not know the Hidden Path guys, but we do, and we think they're good and worth your time. We also felt like we don't, you know the press, and so we hired a PR firm, Zebra Partners, who was great to work with. And like I said, we approached some of these larger companies and said, hey, would you want to help us? We're trying to make more Defense Grid. You guys have said you like the game. Maybe you could help us with you know, be a part of the Kickstarter. We can get some more of your technology in our game, and maybe we can give rewards, you know, of your stuff to people. And people got really excited. AMD jumped in and said, you know what? We're going to give you 600 video cards that you can give away to help make Defense Grid 2. And Razer said, we're going to give you 100 mice. And these guys were awesome. I mean, they aren't getting anything directly in return. We're of course going to make sure that the mice and the video cards are supported in our game, and we added Eyefinity for AMD, and we added, you know, Switchblade support for Razer. But overall, they were saying to the community, we want to support good games. We know these guys. We know their game. We want to help. And it was awesome. We were really, really appreciative. We also knew that we weren't going to be able to manufacture physical goods, and that we didn't know how to deliver the stuff physically or digital. And so we also looked to other partners. Penny Arcade said, hey, we can help you. We have a warehouse. We can grab everything. We can manufacture the shirts. We can do some of the things, and then we can ship them all out to everybody. The Humble Bundle folks said, hey, we can host all your digital content that you're going to give to people and do the code fulfillment for the game. We can make that all work. And then Alibaba.com is where we went initially to you know, find vendors who would make the USB gun towers and the audio buttons. And I will say we worked really hard, we tried really hard, but in the end, the vendors we found there on Alibaba actually didn't end up working out. We actually ended up losing some money, some people just disappeared. And it's been actually a real effort to try and find good manufacturing partners since the Kickstarter to build the gun towers and the buttons. We got some samples early on during the Kickstarter, but once we tried to then go past the sample stage, it actually really turned out to be kind of a problem. And who would have known, right? I mean, we're not folks who make toys generally. So we decide we get this all ready, and at this time AMD and Razer hadn't come on board, and we're thinking, well, that's okay. You know, they were interested, but they weren't sure at this point. And so on May 29th, we thought, let's go out. And we were talking to our friends at EDAR, and these are guys who do real analysis of the game industry. And they said, no, don't go out right over E3. There's going to be so much press noise. No one's going to cover you. Wait until at least after a few weeks after E3. And so we said, okay, June 26th. Will go. And then we continued the conversation with AMD Razer, and by the 26th they're like, okay, I think we're going to do this, but our contracts aren't, you know, signed yet. We're not ready. So let's give it a couple more weeks. And by July 10th everyone was ready to go, and so we said, okay, let's launch. And so there we were. On July 10th we launch, and we find out that this new Android console called Ouya launches on that day, and Penny Arcade themselves do. Penny Arcade sells out Kickstarter all on the same day, and at first we're not sure, is that a good thing, or, you know, are more people going to be on Kickstarter, or is that a bad thing? Are we going to be completely lost in the noise? But we start strong, and we got some initial press coverage, and people were excited because we've had a lot of friends in the press who really love the game, and it's going really well. The first few days are just really exciting, and even as it falls off, we're feeling pretty good because we're ringing around $10,000 a day, and as we track it, we're like, this is going to work. We got to get some people more energized a little bit and get the word out a little bit more, but this is something we can really do. And then we get to the second week, and we see that it really starts falling off. And we're hearing from our partners, our consumers, that maybe the tiers are confusing to people, and that somehow we're a rich game developer, and we shouldn't be on Kickstarter. And we're like blown away by this, because if we had the money to make Defense Grid 2, we wouldn't have done a Kickstarter. And so people assume we have all the money and that we're going to make it anyway and that we're just trying to get more money out of people. And that kind of hurts because, you know, we love making video games. What we're trying to do more than anything else as a business is work more on the games that we design and less on games for other people. And we like working on games for other people, but we love working on games that we get to design and control. And we think we're pretty good at it. And so, you know, Defense Grid, if we can build it, that's what we're going to do. But we didn't have enough. And so that's why we went to Kickstarter. And clearly, we had not made that point very well. The Ouya effect, though, really diminished the amount of press we were getting. I mean, we would call press and they'd say, oh, no, Ouya's the story, can't talk with you. Or later we would hear, oh, you know, we don't really want to cover a Kickstarter. It's like endorsing a product that hasn't shipped yet, and we don't feel good about that. And as we talked more and more, there was a few of the folks in the press who were really willing to cover what was happening. But for the most part, most people said, no, we're not going to cover this. And what we had do, one of the things we thought we had could do is by updating the game, you know, there's, again, almost 500,000 people on Steam that have the game, we could bring in a bunch of new people by doing our Steam updates. That's our biggest way to reach new people. And inside the game, we have an email address sign up so that you could be part of the contest, so that we would know who to award a prize to. But, you know, we're getting 2,000 to 2,500 people by this point of in-game signups, but that's a lot lower than we were hoping for because we were trying to reach hundreds of thousands of people. Our hope was that we would have around 20,000 to 25,000 backers that would get us somewhere between 800,000 and 1,000,000. And in the end of this, as people may know, we got around 7,000 backers or so. And and getting the word out was kind of the big thing. So at this point, we're starting to go, okay, we're not going to make enough. But there's some interest here, and maybe people would want to be involved in this. And so I actually started getting on the phone, talking with some publishers and saying, hey, you know, we could announce that you're involved and move things up a tier or two tiers, and that people could really jump in. And then, because they're a little worried that we're just funding an expansion, we're not funding the whole game. The communication of that these are steps to get to the whole game wasn't working the way we had thought it would. And so there was some interest, and we thought, oh, okay, maybe we're going to get a new partner here that, you know, because of the Kickstarter noise and the excitement that was going to help. And in fact, by the week three, one deal looks very real. We're talking very serious, and it could change everything. They could put in enough money to get us really close to the final, and then we'd do some extra things for them, but all the Kickstarter people would be able to get the Kickstarter at a much smaller minimum bar, and we could you know, announce what that new minimum bar was and update that. But we had to assume that deal wasn't going to happen, and so we tried to get the word out. We did a Spreecast, which is an interesting kind of Q&A with people on video. The team internally did a Twitch TV marathon. We kept doing our weekly updates. We were trying to get people really, you know, into it and excited. And what we saw is that, you know, as we started looking at it, as we get to week four, we noticed that a lot of other Kickstarters, when they weren't doing so well, all of a sudden got a bunch of $10,000 pledges all at one time. And we start thinking, well, is that the smart thing to do? And it feels kind of wrong because, you know, you're not supposed to be backing your own Kickstarter just to make the minimum. But people had been doing it, and we could see that several had done it. And so we're like, well, maybe we should consider that, but now we're not comfortable with that. And so then we started talking about, well, what do we do if we don't hit the minimum? When, you know, does the project die? And at that point, we kind of realized that we had priced as pledge rewards the AMD video cards and the Razer mice probably too high. We had a small handful of people who had said, yeah, I'm willing to spend that kind of money, but we decided to price it lower. And so one of the things we did is we emailed everybody who already had it at a high price and said, hey, we're going to lower the price tomorrow, and, you know, there'll be limited tiers, but we'll make sure you get in a lower price if that's what you want. And some people did do that, and some people kept their pledge right where it was and said, no, I want to give you guys this amount of money. And other people actually said, wow, that's so nice of you for letting us know before you discount. I'm actually going to raise my pledge, which I would have never guessed or never expected. It was completely... People are really amazing. When they get happy and are impressed, they do things you just don't expect. It's really heartwarming. and so what we did is we lowered the price of the video cards first. And what ended up happening, and I'll show you this on later slides, is a bunch of new people came in. And how we reach these people is kind of the interesting story, and we'll get to that. But all these new people came in, you see our amount we're getting per day goes way up, and all of a sudden we become really on track to at least cross the minimum. There is some confusion, and we try, you know, we had written our pledge tiers in a way that they kind of said this tier and the ones below it, and now we were introducing new ones in between, and were they below it, or were they included, were they not, and they weren't supposed to, and we were trying to get Kickstarter to help us change the wording, but they said, no, that wording's fixed. And so, you know, really planning ahead of time to allow yourself to drop in new tiers at lower amounts than you expect, I think is a really important lesson. But these, you know, as we lowered price, the partner products that they donated, all of a sudden they took off and we crossed the minimum and we're really excited. Now we get to at least make the expansion. And so here's kind of what it looks like. The purple line is the hourly pledge amounts. And you can see that a lot of the spikes were very short lived, just, you know, a few hours here, a few hours there as the clock, you know, went around the world and so forth, but as news got out. And the green line was kind of what we expected. It's a cumulative total of all the pledges that came in. The surprise here that I thought was worth pointing out is the red line, which is the number of cancellations or pledge decreases that happened over time. And it increased more and more as we got to the end, where people said, no, I want to pull my money out. And as we talked with more people later, we learned this is common across a lot of Kickstarters. People put in money at one point thinking, well, I'll decide before the end if I really want to or not, and then see how it gets towards the end. And if I'm not happy, I'm going to pull my money out. And so that's what the blue line was. The blue line then was our total, our final total. But you couldn't just look at the green line of the amount coming in. You had to take into account the amount going out as well. And I'll show you some analysis of that here on the next slide. You know, this is kind of at the top is the dollars per day that were either in a new person adding in money, an increase in someone's pledge, a decrease in pledge, or a cancel in pledge, and then the number of actions that took that. And the reason I show both actions and dollars is that it kind of gives you a feel for the number of people that do something and whether or not that's proportional to the amount of money, right? If one person drops $10,000, then it's going to be a very small amount of color on the bottom one and a very large amount on the top. But as you can see for us, we pretty much had generally the similar size colors in both cases. So it was really about people all kind of doing very similar things. And if we look at what that was on the next slide, we had an average of $40 pledge per person for each new person. We had about, you know, and that was $266,000. We had about $35,000 of increased pledges, but also about $13,000 of decreased pledges and about $15,500 of canceled pledges. And so we had heard that, you know, increasing, getting people to increase their pledge over time was really important, but in our Kickstarter, it really ended up being that our increases basically counteracted our cancels and decreases, and that the real Kickstarter result came from just new people coming in and pledging the very first time, which we thought was really interesting result once we studied it. Had I been asked this during the Kickstarter, or even right after, before doing this analysis, I would have told you that pledge increases were really, really important, because they seemed like it was very easy. They were very visible in the way the emails came in and the way we tracked it during the Kickstarter. But looking at it afterwards, it was all about the new people. Now, comparing us to some of the other Kickstarters at the time, we wanted to look at kind of the average per backer. And so you kind of see I've got a bunch of the video games over $100,000 here, and Defense Grid 2 was right there at about $275,000, and we were right at about $43 average. And you see that there's a lot of games that kind of had that same average but just had more backers as they had more dollars. But there was also a lot of games, you know, Star Command Part 2, Code Hero, FTL, that had a much lower, you know, around $20 to $30 average per backer. And then I put in this arbitrary purple line, and so Defense Grid is the green line. The average for everybody here on the left side of the purple line is the red. And then the purple line is where I kind of said, wow, all the ones to the right of the purple line had an inordinate amount of $10,000 pledges in them. And almost all of them had those $10,000 pledges happen right when they needed them to, except for the Jane Jensen adventures. I actually think Jane just has a lot of very wealthy backers who were backing at $10,000 any old time, even long after she had crossed her minimum. But a lot of the others had a bunch of $10,000 pledges that came in right when they needed to cross their minimum. So, you know, it's hard to know if those were if the average that you see from there is based on real backer numbers or if those were inflated by basically self-investment as well. Here it is kind of in a different format. And I include here Double Fine Adventure, Wasteland 2, and Shadowrun Returns, which would have gone off the top of the previous chart. And you see again that average dollar per backer is right around that $42, $43 mark, goes down to maybe $33, $34 for a large group of them, and goes all the way up to maybe $50, $51 for a very large group. And I think us having the physical goods, the video cards and the mice, definitely helped increase our overall average compared to what it would have been otherwise. But working to make your pledge tiers so that you're getting on an average of $40 per person for these types of games, I think makes a real big difference. And so what's interesting here is kind of a breakout of how the money came in. If you see, you know, at the bottom, the percentage of people, a large percentage of people pledged $15 only, or the 20 or 30 where they got digital goods only in green there. And then, you know, over 5%, you see some posters at $55, and the video cards at $105 got close to 3 or 4% of people. But you know, if I sum it all up with the pie chart at the right on the percentage of people, 72% of people did a digital tier or below. 18% of people did a tier that had a manufactured good that we, you know, a gun tower, audio button, a t-shirt, a poster. And then 10% of the people chose a tier that had a video card or a mouse. But if we go to the top of the chart, where we look at the tiers and the dollars they're responsible for, the percentage of dollars they're responsible for, you see that the posters and the video cards and the mice are responsible for a lot larger percentage. And if we go all the way and sum them all up to the pie chart, we basically have a third, a third, a third in money, even though most of the people were in the lower end tiers digital. So I think it was really important for us from a dollar point of view to have these physical goods and have these premium physical goods as well. But you know, from an individual point of view, those appealed to a smaller audience. So this slide then goes into the fact of how many people are you able to bring in. I think this is one of the key things to know about at least our Kickstarter experience. And looking again at the other Kickstarters that we think were similar, again, the Shadowrun Returns, Wasteland, Double Fine that are here, you see brought in large number of people, 35,000, 60,000, 85,000. We had hoped to bring in somewhere around 20,000. The Castle Story and Banner Saga at the Banner Saga was right. Castle Story actually grew from this, as did Planetary Annihilation. This was captured at the time of, you know, in late August when I did these charts. And you see that we got 6,291, and we were hoping, you know, to make an impact on the 550,000 PC users by updating the game on Steam, and we were hoping to get around 3 or 4% of those people, which would have got us, you know, around 18 to 24,000 people. But in the end, we were only able to really reach 1.1% of them, and the average for most of this is around 7,000 backers. So we came pretty close to the average, even though we worked very hard, you know, to try and exceed that average. One of the most interesting things I think that you do get from Kickstarter is where the referrer comes in for a person who does place money on your Kickstarter. The largest one was Google or direct to the page, so you don't know where that came from. But the green bars here and the green pie chart show different pages where someone found it on Kickstarter itself, then came into our Kickstarter and pledged some money, and around 32% or so of all the money we collected came from people finding us on Kickstarter. Maybe they had known about us again, but they came to Kickstarter and found us that way. About 20% came in through press articles, direct links, links that were actually in press articles. And this is really interesting because never before have we gotten to know how impactful a press article would be from a dollar point of view. And here you can see that people who read Rock Paper Shotgun, who then clicked the link to the Kickstarter on Rock Paper Shotgun, came in and bid around $14,000. And people who saw about the Video Guard news on slickdeals.net came in and spent around $13,000. And Reddit, AMA, you know, brought in, the people who clicked on the link there brought it, came in around $6,000. And people who read the article on PCGamer.com came in and brought about $5,000. And so on. And we had kind of an interesting way of saying, wow, the way we got covered in Joystick versus the way we got covered in Rock, Paper, Shotgun made a material difference to how the Kickstarter worked. And then the light blue are the links we placed on our Facebook pages, on Twitter, on Steam forums, you know, where we emailed people directly. And so I'm going to, you know, make the assertion that those are both the press articles and the links that we placed are probably proportionately taking up the direct-to-page or coming in via Google, that people heard about from press and then typed something into Google, or heard about it from one of our links and typed it into Google. And so those two pie slices probably should appropriately take over the purple pie slice, but we don't know what came from the purple pie slice. But I found that really interesting. And if you kind of do a study here, we look at the Kicktrack website on the Steam Bandits Outpost. And this is a really classic look because they weren't getting any press. They weren't getting any backers. They didn't have even, you know, 120 backers before they got a little bit of press. And then, you know, they got a little blurb in Joystick, a little blurb in IGN. You can see that was worth $1,700 or $1,200. But then they were on the, you know, several days later, they were on the front page of Kotaku for several hours, and that brought in $17,000 and 540 people. And you could see it directly. And it was just kind of amazing that getting out to people, getting that reach, making people aware of your Kickstarter made a huge difference. And, you know, Planetary Annihilation was going on just as we were finishing. And they had over almost 20,000 backers in a very short period of time with a very high per backer pledge amount. And one of the things that they had was a great reach, not only a story about a company that was making a big game, but also, you know, they operate Super Monday Night Combat. They have access to a huge, huge emailing list to let their users know about the other things they're doing. And so that this looked, wow, this is a way they could get the word out, and people then who are interested could come and decide to pledge. But if they didn't know about it, people who are interested wouldn't come. I don't think anyone's trying to convince people who aren't interested to do a Kickstarter, because I just don't think there's a good sell there. But I think being able to let people who know, who are interested, know about it is actually a really, really important thing. On this next slide, I kind of did a chronological history of game Kickstarters that were over $100,000. You actually see that Code Hero crossed $150,000 before Double Fine broke the whole lid open at $3.3 million, and then Faster Than Light. And you kind of see, and then you see kind of over time some decrease in the amount of offers or how much they raised, and where we were, you know, Ouya, I didn't count here, and then Planetary Annihilation and Castle Story grew a little bit more, and Planetary Annihilation grew quite a bit more as time went on. But I thought it was really interesting to watch how things progressed over time, as you almost see kind of a decreasing and then before an increasing, as perhaps maybe it's a summer month thing. Perhaps it's just what the offers were. I'm not sure what the trends mean, but I thought it was really interesting data. So the question is, how did it turn out for us? And I think we're really excited because we got over 6,300 people engaged through Kickstarter. Several hundred more have come on since the Kickstarter. So we're almost with a community now of almost 7,000 people. And we raised $271,000. Now, of that, just kind of interesting, about 2% of people didn't pay their even though they had a credit card, it didn't charge their credit card. It was a failed credit card transaction. They didn't have the credit, or the card was bad. And so there was about $5,500 that didn't pass through. Kickstarter took their 5%, which was $13,000. Amazon took a percentage of those that went through, and that was $10,264. Kickstarter takes a percentage even of those that don't go through, interestingly enough. We're projecting about $45,000 is what's going to cost us to get all the shirts and the video cards and the mice out, shipped, and the gun towers and buttons manufactured. And that's going to leave, you know, under $200,000 towards game development. But to get there, we spent around 10 person months designing the campaign, researching tools, all the stuff. Obviously, we received donations from A&D and Razer, but if we were to do a true return on investment, we probably spent almost half of the money that we raised in trying to get the Kickstarter done. So a very small amount ends up going towards new products, sadly. But in part, we did that because we were trying to raise much, much more, and we felt like that was well worth it. So our takeaways from this whole thing is that, in our minds at least, getting the word out to your audience is a key to is at least one key to Kickstarter success. And the question I think you need to ask yourself before doing a Kickstarter is, can you independently contact your audience? Do you need someone else to contact your audience for you, and will they? Or do you have a way to reach your audience yourself? And at least in going through the press, at the time of our Kickstarter, the press was going through an extreme, what they called, Kickstarter fatigue. I don't want to cover Kickstarter. I've already covered too many Kickstarters. I'm not sure if the things I'm covering right now are even going to be real. I don't want to cover your Kickstarter. We heard that a lot. And it was really quite sad, because we felt like, well, we're an established company who's shipped several products, and this is going to be real. But that story didn't really catch on, at least with the press. And some of the press it did, but not all of it. Obviously, another approach where we've seen from Castle Story or Banner Saga or a few others is that having a really new, compelling thing breaks through and gets a lot of people. But often, and those you know Kickstarters that had a large number of people but didn't have an installed audience had typically a lower per backer pledge amount, which I thought was an interesting correlation. As I mentioned earlier, Kickstarter odds are much more challenging than game development odds. How do you value that community factor? I think we're really excited about it. We now have a group we can talk to. They're giving us feedback. They're playing a beta right now of our game, and we're very excited about that. And the feedback is better than anything we've gotten. So we're expecting that this expansion is going to be better than anything we've done before, because we're able to tweak it in a way. But yeah, we would totally think twice before investing as much in the content development we did for the campaign. It was hard to see that our continuous updates in the original game helped the Kickstarter as much as we had hoped we would. We suspect that some of the larger Kickstarters have potentially self-backed more than we thought, so be careful when you look at the average backer amount that you would expect if you're going to try and have really good pledge tiers. We obviously heard all the time, why do you want so much money for just this kind of game or just that kind of game? And everyone believes that game development should cost a lot less, and I'd love for it to cost less. It would make my life so much better, but the reality is the reality, and you got to budget for the reality. And I think we would have only been successful, at least in this model, because we had the partners, AMD, Razer, Penny Arcade, Humble Bundle, Zebra Partners. Those folks all helped us be successful, and we couldn't have done this alone. So my hope is that by giving you all this information and data, it gives you a little insight into our Kickstarter experience. We're glad we did it. We're really excited about the community we have. It's not necessarily the best way to make a lot of money, but it's a really good way to engage with your consumers, make some money, and for some people, they're making a tremendous amount of money and unlocking their ability to make games. We still plan on making Defense Grid 2, but we don't have enough cash yet to do so. So we're back to talking with some partners and trying to get some deals done. And because of the Kickstarter, things look better than they did even before. So I think it's going to happen, but exactly when it's going to happen, I'm not sure. We've told our backers, hey, we're going to make this expansion, we're going to deliver you all these rewards, and we're going to totally deliver on that. And then we've told them, when we get to make Defense Grid 2, we're going to give you a copy of that too, because you came in and backed us, you know, early on. And when we can totally do that, give them keys to the sequel when it gets made. What I can't do is say when it's going to get made and how it's going to get made, because we didn't raise enough for it. But anyway, I hope all of this helps you get a little extra insight into at least our experience of the Hidden Path Defense Grid 2 Kickstarter, and I hope this video has been enjoyable. Thanks!